It has activated at last. But it doesn't feel like you expected. An intense pain explodes in your skull, and a wrenching tug in your gut. The chamber is pulling you inside it, forcibly ripping your mind from your body. Oh man, I wanted to fight the sorrow. And if the screams are any indication, you aren't the only one. Yeah, I didn't know what the glow around her was. I thought it was from the resonance chamber. And I decided to look at her, you know, fetals and that, and I absorb all damage from the sorrow. So what happens now? Tension is mounting. Oh!
I'm ready to learn something new.
Quest failed for covetous hearts. I did that quest. I gave him Dracogen. That's Dracogen's quest. I gave him the cortex, the navigational cortex, in exchange for the magmatic amulet. I didn't fail it. The familiar figure of the ghostly woman looks around her, seemingly even more confused than when you first encountered her here in your mind. Her eyebrows raise high in some sudden realization. It has begun. What has begun? She looks at you as if noticing you for the first time. If I'm understanding everything correctly, which is far from certain, the end has begun. You're a cast-off, she says, as though confirming it to herself, a spark of life left over when your body was otherwise abandoned. She looks up and around her, as though able to see something you cannot in the black expanse. They're all here. The spark, the consciousness, of every living cast-off is here now, in the labyrinth. They were drawn here by the resonance chamber. I thought the chamber was supposed to stop the sorrow. The chamber was just a lever. She speaks as though she is just learning this information herself. The sorrow can be stopped, but not by flipping some switch in the real world. Your fate, and that of your siblings, will be decided here, in the labyrinth that connects you all, that has always connected you. She shuts her eyes. There's a place called the resonance, she intones, a door in the deepest fathoms. Eyes still closed, she points to a new portal that wasn't there before. The resonance still lies through there. You must find it. Your body is the key. Open it. Enter it. Then you can stop the sorrow and be free.
My journal.
Suddenly the ground and even the sky shake violently. You clutch your head in pain, as though someone had pounded on the inside of your skull. Gradually the pain subsides. The air stills and quiets, but the ghostly woman's eyes are wide, her mouth agape. He's already here. The changing god has broken through to the doorstep of the resonance. He'll have to force the door open, though. You have time to reach him, to stop him. She looks gravely into your eyes, but not much time. How do you know all of this? Her brow furrows. I'm still asking myself that. When you and your siblings were drawn into this place, pieces of their memories filled gaps in mine. I know what happened to bring you here. I understand what is happening now, and I know where the changing god is and what he plans to do. She shakes her head. And yet there is so much I don't know. Who am I? Why do I know all of this, and you don't? I feel like I know the labyrinth. Why does it... She bites her lip, unable to voice any more questions. She thinks, why does it feel like this labyrinth was created for me? Huh. Is the ghostly woman me? When your siblings were drawn into this place, their memories began filling the gaps in mine. There's still much I don't know, but I can sense the danger you're in. The danger we're all in. If all living castoffs were drawn to this place, then where are they? She shakes her head sadly. They are lost. The chamber drew in their minds and then trapped them, each one with an illusion made from their fears and regrets. I can feel them now. Her eyes shut tight and she bites her lip. Their pain. Their torment. They don't realize where they are, and they cannot escape. not on their own. If everyone is trapped in an illusion, why aren't I? She cocks her head to the side. Because you are the last cast-off, she says, as though it were obvious. Every cast-off who has met you tells me the same things. You are the latest version. Your body was designed for this. Do you ever wonder why you could remember or control the labyrinth when no other cast-off could before? Does this mean that activating the chamber did nothing at all? Not nothing. You activated the chamber, and so have a greater power here than others. More clarity and control. Why has everything changed? All the doors and portals are different from before. She bows her head in thought. Without looking up, she says, The labyrinth is a dreamscape shared by the changing god and all his cast-offs. Its shape is defined by your minds. All of your minds. She looks you in the eye. I think the sudden influx of hundreds of cast-offs, each with their own lives and memories, has made the labyrinth unpredictable, causing even more change as they move through it. As to where these other portals go? She looks over at the shimmering doors that weren't there before. I don't know. I only know that that one over there, she points in the opposite direction, leads down to the resonance. That is the way you must ultimately go if you are to stop the changing god. Tell me how to stop him again. You will find him in the lower depths of the labyrinth, on the doorstep of the resonance. He is forcing his way even now. If you don't worry, he will succeed. Let's try to stop him. Farewell. Wait, there is one more thing. The labyrinth has become a volatile thing. Everything is changing. Even now I can feel the portal that leads to the resonance trying to close. Make sure you have everything you need before you descend. For once you start, you may not be able to return here at all. Okay, so wander around and make sure I have everything I need, but hurry. Good luck. The swirling depths flicker with mysteries and powers you cannot define. That goes to the Sorrow's Fathom. That's the path to the Resonance. The Crefton Fathom? The Village Fathom? The Oasis Fathom? Clock Fathom and Daughter's Fathom. We've seen that. Should I go through all these first? Let's see if we can talk to these people. If they have anything new to say. Saria? Nothing new. Choi? Bok Choi? Interfer is up here. None of them have anything new to say, which surprises me. So these are the Clock Fathom and the Daughter's Fathom. I've been there to both of them. So let's leave. Ghostly woman, Saria. Or Taglio. Or Lady Anch? The hazy form of Artaglio, the captain of the Irregulars, stands here. He's staring around the calm, as if trying to place what he's doing here. He holds up his hands and stares at them. Through them. I suppose this is immortality of a sort, huh, Castoff? What a place you have here, Castoff. Do all of you have one of these in your heads? He leans in. I'm hearing all kinds of whispers, you know, like, there's more in here than we can see. How are things here, Artaglio? I don't feel real, like I'm Incomplete. At least there's plenty of rum here.
Huh.
Are you happy to be here? You tell me, Castoff. He gestures broadly. This looks like some sort of place where anyone is happy. At least I'm not in the bloom anymore. Tell me a story from your life? He thinks, his eyes squinting shut. I'm remembering wars and women and laughter. One time we rolled into a town that was supposed to be hostile, and they threw us the biggest party. After a while we got blackout drunk, even our sentries. We woke up stark naked in the morning, surrounded by mud as far as the eye could see. No sign of the town, no buildings, no inhabitants, and we never could find it again. His face falls. Lost my favorite boots there, too. Any other stories? Too foggy to remember any more, Castoff. I'll let you know if I want to tell some. Like we really have time for this. Share a drink and form a connection with our Taglio. A bottle forms in his hands. He passes it to you, and you share its contents. A wave of tipsy contentment washes over you, and you feel your body's muscles suddenly adjusting to the memories and experiences Artaglio's reflection offers. We got Artaglio's cunning. You happy here? He laughs sourly. Does it really matter? Okay, so what do we have? Artaglio's cunning. All companions in short range gain Artaglio's cunning. Plus 5 initiative, plus 15% willpower, plus 10% on persuasion tasks, and plus 20% damage. Sweet. He might be a drunkard, but Artaglio brings decades of tactical experience to every battle he fights, and now he's sharing that knowledge with you. Now I like Artaglio. Lady Ench. No. Leave me alone, you vultures. Lady Ench, the entrepreneurial castoff from Milavest, is in tears. She flaps her ornamented hands desperately in the air, her face stretched in sorrow and regret. As you step closer, you catch shades, flickers in the corner of your eye, of what she is seeing. Luxurious fabrics, marvelous oddities, and expensive-looking devices of all kinds are arrayed around her like a hoard, and several shadows are taking it all away from her. She tries to grab her treasures before they can be stolen, but her hands flap through them like mist. Please, she cries, I can pay you back. Just give me more time. There's nothing there. It isn't real. Blue tie, tiny amount. What? She blinks, and like a dream, all the shades and shadows fade away. Gradually, she recognizes you. Little sister? What a nightmare. My business had gone bankrupt. Everything was being taken from me. She shakes her head. I'm not ashamed to admit it's my greatest fear. Thank you for saving me from that. I feel like I've been given a second life. She looks around her for the first time. Where are we? What devilry has landed us here? We're in my mind. Our sire's resonance chamber drew us here. Silvertide? Is that so? She gets an odd glint in her eye. A mental landscape, perhaps. And you and I were able to dismiss these visions with mere belief. I wonder if... She holds out one bejeweled hand and focuses on it intently. Suddenly, two vibrating crystal shards appear in the air above her head, orbiting each other and emitting a sharp wooden scent. Ha! She barks. I love this item. I import them from Haraf, you know. They do nothing except add to decor, but I can sell them for far more than most oddities. She grabs the crystals and puts them into her pocket. It would seem this place lets me do more than shoo away shadows, yes? Can you produce anything you want in here? She looks at her hand, creating several different fantastical items. Some you recall seeing from her illusion, but also failing to create others. Not anything, it would appear, but some things. I can't say I understand the methodology behind it. She thinks, related to my businesses, perhaps? I wonder. Can you make something that would help me in here? Let's see, shall we? Suddenly, several useful items appear next to her. She smiles. Take what you like. Oh. I can just take any of this stuff? Nice. I'm gonna take all of it. I'm buying it for zero. Gladiator's Will. Plus one might edge, plus five armor. Active until next sleep. This appears to be a collar made from a well-worn and blood-soaked piece of brown leather. It is fitted with a dull, rusted iron ring in the center. It thrums with a palpable sense of both rage and anguish. It provides the wearer with a surge of might in a moment of desperation. Upon use, the ring stops drumming and is forever still and quiet. This goes into ornament, I guess? Oh, it's a cipher. I'll leave that for now in case there's more ciphers. Amplified Encephalic Rush. Three more of those. Hyperalliterated Force. I just keep checking. Nice. Refined Fleetfoot Moss, two of those. And buying these for zero. A Cacophony Blade. Ooh. 18 physical damage, plus 2 damage per effort applied to a max of plus 15. Ah, oh, this would be awesome for Aretes. Not to compare it with that hammer, of course, but I don't know where he is or if I'm going to be fighting with him anymore. The cruel blade of this two-handed sword is... Oh, a critical hit deals 8 mental damage to all enemies in immediate range. I forgot that one. The cruel blade of this two-handed sword is a massive black stone chunk, studded with semi-sentient spikes across its upper edge. The spikes shiver with hunger, and when you touch one of the spikes with your finger, it wriggles eagerly, as if trying to detach and dig into your flesh. When the spikes hit a target just the right way, a number of them fly off and burrow into anyone within range. Whenever you use the weapon this way, a demonic-sounding screeching fills your ears. Done. I want to hear the screeching. A Patronal? Light-range weapon. 12 energy damage, plus 3 damage per effort applied to a max of plus 18. On hit, confer Patronal's fire. Minus 1 resistance. Oh, to, enemies, obviously. Active 2 rounds. This surprisingly heavy projectile weapon possesses a very wide grip and is uncomfortable for a human hand to wield. When the user places a finger upon the trigger, concealed lights flicker across the weapon's surface like flames. Firing this weapon causes an increase in body temperature, and the smell of wood smoke emanates from the user's body, though it doesn't cause any lasting harm. We also got a temporal hammer. 16 physical damage, plus 2 per effort applied to a max of plus 12, plus 30% on melee weapon attacks. This warhammer looks ordinary at first glance. Careful observation reveals that the head is constantly shifting forward and backward in time. The head of the hammer is actually a time displacement device that exists in many moments at once, making it all the more difficult to evade. A machinery lore tells me that the time displacement device was once part of a larger structure. Its temporal energies are limited in scope, capable of moving forward or backward in time by a few seconds at most. It wasn't designed for greater range, so you can only speculate as to what sort of device required such narrow movements through time. Huh. Okay. Here's a sapient blade. 10 physical damage, plus 4 damage per effort to a max of plus 16. Plus 15% to critical hit chance of weapon attacks. On critical hit, wielder gains sapient blade, which is plus 5 mental damage, active for 3 rounds. The joints of this crooked blade flex and creak at the touch. On closer inspection, some of the edges aren't tangible unless focused upon. It's all free, so we might as well grab it all. Alright, so we're going to take this cipher. Plus 1 might edge, plus 5 armor. You're okay. We're only one over, I think. Yeah, we're one over. Can we level up? Stat pool. I don't know. We have so much intellect. Screw it. Go all intellect. Oh, 1 point remaining? Let's do another might.
I've learned something new.
Cool. Is it this? No, no. Ambush? I don't recognize that. You guys can read it if you want to. I don't know what's new. Targeting eye? I think I had this. Yeah. Mind barrier? Is it all our stuff from our friends? Nocturnal? Yeah. Surprise attack? Scan thoughts we had. Adaptation? I wish I could level up our other friends, but they're not with us. Hello again, sister. What can I do for the woman who rescued me from my greatest fear? Can I see what you can make again? Certainly. I should have anything new. I would keep taking stuff, you know that. Now I think we can also rest here? Yeah, we don't need to. We're fine. But good to know. So this is Sorrow's Fathom, which we've been to. These are Crefton Fathom. These are new. So I think I'm going to try, of course I'm going to be saving the game, I'm going to try to go through one or all of these. Maybe our companions are hiding out in these, and I can get them back. That'd be cool. Who knows, maybe they're thrown in one of these as well. But these are new, I'll try these out. If I die or the game ends because I took too long and I'm not supposed to go through them, then I'll reload. Because I'm going to save right here. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Stay tuned for the next episode and enduring. Cross strong.